Ladies and gentlemen, we are live.
Oh my God, who the hell cares?
Alrighty then, welcome ladies and gentlemen to another edition of the bar on VRS, the Veteran Radio Syndicate. I am your host, John Kermian, aka Mini. 2311 was my MOS in the United States Marine Corps. I'm a car carrier member of the E4 Mafia and OG of the Veteran Radio Syndicate, and most times the most intoxicated host on Facebook Live. Joining me as usual, motley crew, I have Mr. Chris Cornell, a.k.a. the Compound Commander, a.k.a. the Blue Falcon. He's a United States Army veteran with a trip to the sandbox. He is also a Blue Falcon, but, you know, whatever. You do what you can do. I fire him every week, but he keeps going back. I love him. He's been with me from the very, very, very beginning. And he has a very unique talent to do almost absolutely nothing, do an entire show, yet still come up with one grain of truth that is almost mind-blowing. For that, I love him. Mrs. Jade Lopez also joins us, a.k.a. the Tech Squirrel, a.k.a. Combat Cricket, a.k.a. Little Lopez. She's also a United States Army veteran, as well as a Blue Falcon with a trip to the sandbox. Unfortunately, she's a little off tonight. She's been dancing the Dance Monkey for about 3.5 hours straight, and she almost had a conniption fit when she couldn't find her favorite Colorado Rockies hat. Why anybody would have a favorite Colorado Rockies hat, I'm not sure. I mean, maybe if you were like a 300 hitter, you would own one just because every time you go there, you can launch balls 17% further than anywhere else. Probably should be a pretty popular place with hookers. Dun-dun-dun-tsh. Anyways, George Pardos, our HMFIC, should be joining us here shortly. Thankfully, he spared us this week from his treadmill routine, which is on audio kind of sounds like a very terrible, obscene phone call. So thank you, George, for that. But thanks everybody for tuning in early, and please make sure you share out the show. Need all the help we can get. I've been tracking numbers, and I can tell already that Facebook's gonna fuck us a little bit tonight. So all the shares you can give us, any page you control, personal pages, encourage people to share it, We certainly appreciate it. I want to thank our sponsors, Warrior Point. That's Warrior Point with an E.org. Join Warrior Point. Become part of the uncommon few. They have chapters in every single state, so there is no excuses. They have a tremendous amount of resources for veterans to help us navigate the day-to-day world that we find ourselves in and power through those obstacles that we seem to find ourselves in all the time. What else is going on? Let's see if I can do the lineup here. It's changed quite a bit here and there. So, on Mondays at 2000 Eastern Standard Time, you have Monday Night Mayhem, the newly coined name for the No Name Show, with my lovely friend, Miss Judy. What am I with Judy Lopez there?
Oh, you're such a fanboy.
I'm such a fanboy. And my mentor and longtime friend, Lunchbox. They had a great show on Monday. If you didn't see it, go to the VRS page, Smart Gun 5 Radio page, the bar, Sports Church, and probably any of the other shows on VRS, and it's up there. They had a great gentleman on there doing cool things and great things for veteran suicide, so check that out. Of course, it's always fun to check out Judy and Lunchbox. Tuesdays at 1800 Eastern Standard Time, you have the WO Radio Show with Goose and Richie the Redneck Pip King. And follow that shortly thereafter, I believe at 2000 Eastern Standard Time, you have Fence Line Country with J-Dub. Wednesdays, of course, at 2000, you've got The Bar with Moi. Lil Lopez, a.k.a. the Attack Chickamauga, a.k.a. Combat Cricket, and the Blue Falcon. Thursdays is the Warrior Walt with George Parlos at 2100 Eastern Standard Time. Friday is... We don't have a Friday night show except for J-Dub's Fence Line Country at 2200 East... Or not Fence Line Country, excuse me. Friday Night Debauchery. It's a show I've been on like six times. I can't fucking remember the name. That's awesome. Good job. But J-Dub hosts that on the Spreaker side, just like Fence Line Country. Saturday is still wide open until the past the Twilight Hour with the Blackout Lounge with Trags, Miss Jade, and various special guests. We Stebro, Salty Seaman, myself have been on there a couple of times when my wife lets me. And then Sunday is Super Sunday at 1400. You've got Spearhead Shenanigans with Goose on the Spreaker side. Make sure you check that out. Guy's got a golden voice. He has a voice for radio. He does. I hate his voice so much. It's so fucking good. But then you look at him and you're like, I don't feel so bad because you're uglier than dog shit. I love you though, but you know.
Quite nice.
He knows. Jesus Christ, how many times have I said it? You know. He comes. He hits back. He hits back. He's a Marine. He knows. And then at 1700, and not ironically, well, finally ironically, I guess if you will. 1700 somewhere is on at 1700 Eastern Standard Time, and that's with Ethan, who just shaved his beard and now looks like the dude who drives in a tinted van picking up school children.
Huge mistake.
He's huge. I'm growing it back. I'm like, yeah, bro, it's going to take like a year. I love him, though. And Cameron, our former Submariner, and sometimes Gunny makes an appearance. If you don't know who Gunny is, well, yes, you don't need to know. You need to find the fuck out. Following that is Sports Church at 1900 Eastern Standard Time with myself, Pops, Pterodactyl, and Pookie. Pookie won't be with us this Sunday, so I'm going to have to hit up some poor soul to argue sports with me while I drink. But, you know, hey, it's good times. All right, let's check in with everybody. Chris Cornell, your internet isn't doing too bad right now. Well, hold on a second. Let me check in with the chat room and encourage these guys to share and gals to share some more. John Woodruff's in there. What's going on? Lancaster Bradley, what's going on, brother? He's got an MP. Oh, another Blue Falcon. Oh, no. Oh, no, Mr. Bill. Richie the Redneck Pimp King is in here. Raymond Trueblood, what's going on, brother? The music that's played in the music and the graphics that were played during the intro, that's Raymond Trueblood. So, he does good shit, and he's always working on it. And I appreciate that he spent a lot of time making that for the bar. Dean Cerny, oh fuck! I knew. I was wondering. I was wondering where he was. He's usually one of the first ones in, but he was a little late, and he's probably rubbing one out to Hillary Clinton or something. Anyways, love you. Just kidding. Just, I was trying to get, I got it. I was just trying to get her to fucking choke and spit out her drink. And I was half successful. I love you, Dean. All right, so here we go. Bar tradition. To those who paved the way for us, to those that we served with, to those poor, unfortunate, crazy bastards who fall in our footsteps, to those we lost in far off lands, and to those we lost to the demons at home, the bar salutes you. Oh, I'm getting a little too old to do the arm thing, but you know, I just did it and looked at myself. What are you doing, dude? You're like 43. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. All right. All right. All right. So Dean Cernan there. Who else has popped in? Oh, my brother-in-law, Mr. Jerome Vinny, popped in. I didn't get a notification. It was on working on the four-wheeler. Got snow coming. Yeah, good call, brother. Get that shit fucking fixed. You never know. I don't know how much you're gonna get. We ain't gonna get shit here. It's fucking Cincinnati, it's Ohio River Valley. We're gonna get like, we're not gonna get anything. I'm probably gonna have to work tomorrow. Fuck. Thursdays are always the worst day for me. My boss knows it too. So he usually buys me a Red Bull. A lot of times. Here, drink this. No. Drink it. No. Drink it or go home. I'll drink it. He's never actually done that. I mean, he has bought me Red Bulls, but he knows Thursday mornings for the first hour and a half or two are not usually too good for me. So, but I think we're going to sneak in work tomorrow. I think all this bullshit is supposed to stop at around 10 in the morning-ish. So, if we got some shit we can do with, like, pole saws and power sticks on the ground or just drop some little trees, we can do that. Yeah, so that was my week. Was kind of been shitty for work, man. Monday and Tuesday, it just rained and sleeted, and no, we don't work. Actually, John was like, "You're working today?" I'm like, "Yeah, bro." He's like, "How do you work in the rain?" I'm like, "If we got to hit the numbers and we don't have to climb, then we'll go and do something." A lot of times, like if we have a job in the backlog that we just drop trees from the ground and whatnot, then that's what we're gonna do. So that's what we did, and I think I finally dried off for Monday and Tuesday, and tomorrow I'm probably gonna get wet again. Again, thank you everybody for sharing. Please continue to share the show. We need the help tonight. I don't think we're gonna hit fucking 800 if we don't get some help. I just look at the numbers from other shows and I'm like, alright, so what's new, Chris Cornell? What's happening? How you doing? What's going on with your sitch, if you will?
Oh, dear Lord, baby Jesus. I need spring to happen, John.
Yeah.
I hate this emotional roller coaster that the weather's got rain and cold and dreary. Other than that, I'm still looking for... I'm feeling better about my job. I don't think it's going anywhere, but I have taken the opportunity to drop the resume, so I'm putting resumes out everywhere. Florida, I even put one out over by Ohio. I've decided that I'd like to make $100,000 a year straight time. So I've just been putting into high paying jobs. Maybe somebody will take me here in a year or so.
There you go. I like it. Just keep putting them out there. You're going to get, for every 100 you set out, you're probably going to get 99 rejections. But you get yes might be the job that you actually really want.
So. I got rejected by General Dynamics for a job that looked like it was perfect for me. And it was $100,000 to $120,000 a year. You know why I got rejected?
Why?
No active security clearance. I let that shit lapse, man.
Oh, fuck. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, that's important, man. I got offered, when I got out of the Marine Corps, I got offered I actually got offered a lot of jobs. Nothing ridiculous, but like realistic. And one of them was for Callaway Golf in San Diego, and the other one was for Motorola in Phoenix. And it was security. And, I mean, they were fucking ridiculous. I swear to God. Like, why do all good men do stupid shit? Usually a woman involved. Sorry, but it's true. Especially in my case. I want to go back to Midwest. I got a $65,000 starting entry-level, not entry-level job, but it's in that field, it's considered entry-level. No, I want to go back to Midwest. Like, oh, that's fucking awesome. Thanks. So, yeah, now I'm making 32 grand a year. One of the poorest I've been since I was like 30. All right, so, dude, what's going on? Dean Cerny, I got rejected by Walmart as a greeter. No way. No way. That's so surprising. That is so
speciesism.
Dude, you're scary as fuck. What the fuck do you... I love it. I know he's trolling, but that's funny. If you actually did that, I'm going to fucking pass out. But all right, Mrs. Jade Lopez. Anybody send a word out to Pardos? Somebody send word out to Pardos. Mrs. Jade Lopez, what's going on? What's new? What's happening?
Not much. Just been dealing with the snow and stuff like that. Like I was telling you guys earlier, like my son, for whatever method to the madness reason, is off until Tuesday now, from tonight till Tuesday. So he's here with me tonight, and he's a sassy little squirrel.
A sassy little squirrel. How old is he?
He's going to be 11 in March.
So he's about as tall as you?
No, actually, I did not bless him with height, if you could imagine that. But, yeah, he was mumbling something, and I don't know exactly what he was mumbling about, but I was like, you want to fight, bro? And he literally flew across the room like I have before. He's like, you're definitely mine. Another you're definitely mine story.
Gotcha.
I caught him, though.
Sorry, I'm seeing if anybody in the chat wants to, anybody in the VRS chat wants to jump on. Since Pardos is...
I consider having children, Jay. It just sounds awful, though. So I decided not
don't
to
have
any myself.
You got like a
You still keep track of your number?
You got like two fire teams. You only have two fire teams.
I decided not to have children. I came to this decision last week.
Oh.
You can't have that old stuff against me.
Oh, that was an attempt at a joke. I got it. All right. We need to work on your...
But and I thought it was pretty good.
Well, okay. That's fine. That's fine. Let me get back in the chat here after I put my thing out there. I'm looking for a third co-host because Pardos is MIA. yeah. And he'll probably show up in the middle of a great argument and take over for like 20 minutes. What?
No, listen to me.
Can I say something real quick?
please.
No, that's him.
Make it short. Oh, it's like 10 minutes 25 later.
25 minutes later.
I love him. He's very smart.
We love you, Pardos. Don't fire us.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about this, too. There's Mr. Lunchbox, a.k.a. Josh Miller. Richie, the Redneck Pimp King, says mentioned Justin's petition. So you can go to, just about, I'm the only one who doesn't have it up there, only because I've done it like 40 times. But I think Jay's got it up on her page, Judy's got it up, Lunchbox has got it up. I think it's on the World Radio page. It's a petition from change.org to pressure the Veterans Administration to step the fuck up on veterans' health. Please seek it out and find it. It shouldn't take you anybody more gifted at Facebook than me, which is pretty much everybody. You can find that or just go to change.org and look it up. Petition for VA mental health reform, and sign it and share it and spread it out. Share it is important because the more shares it gets, the more exposure it gets. It's just like anything. And the more people sign it, the more effect it's going to have. Hopefully, I pray.
So the specific petition is actually about having at least the VA staff 24-hour mental health staff. You know, instead of a veteran who actually has dragged up the strength and courage and everything else that it truly does take strength and courage to go and seek help. But then get turned away and told we don't have anyone here, go home.
Yeah.
At the very least, they should staff somebody 24 hours, or you know, if they don't have somebody 24 hours on staff there, they need to foot the bill for a civilian hospital, because the civilian ERs have 24-hour staff.
Yeah, they do. And
and it should be no questions asked as far as that bill. That bill will, should not be denied if it, if they got sent to a civilian ER.
No, and it can't get done.
The governments pay for that, at least here in Illinois. When they have somebody like that, the county's got a crisis case manager, and they service all the hospitals. I just happen to know the woman that used to do that.
Does she service a VA hospital as well?
No, that's why.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, yeah, I know civilians do. I mean, I had to take my second wife to St. Elizabeth because, well, I mean, short backstory: cancer, alcoholism. Like, it was, she was not in a good place, and I, it was nothing to get her admitted, but it was a voluntary hold. And she fucking walked out like 12 hours later and was gone for like a week. It was not a fun week for me, but yeah, I totally agree that mental health across the board, especially veterans, if we seek out help, it's probably pretty fucking serious. In most cases, probably 98% of the cases, it's fucking serious.
Especially in the middle of the night.
Because we're not fucking good at that shit. We're fucking terrible. We're terrible. I had appendicitis for 5 days before I went to the hospital. I should have fucking died. You know, if anybody's had that, knows the pain. I had it for 5 days. It started on a Sunday. I didn't go to the fucking hospital till Thursday night. And they're like, yeah, your appendix is about to burst. We already prepped the OR, emergency prepped the OR. You're going in about 15 minutes. Here's some Dilaudid and have fun. So yeah, I know we're terrible at it. We are, it's bred into us in a certain extent. But once you're out, it doesn't get much easier. And when we do go reach for help, it's probably pretty fucking serious because we're at our end of our rope. Like, all right, I can't go on. I can't keep doing this. Whether it's the pain, whether it's the mental anguish, so that needs to fucking happen. It really does, and there's no reason it shouldn't. I mean, yes, it's going to cost money, sure. But, you know, an easy solution is hire a brand new ER doctor, hire a brand new out of college psychiatrist, and let them earn their bones. And if you can find a veteran that fits either one of those, even better. Because it's much easier for us to lay down and open up to somebody who's raised their right hand. It just is. I mean, you watch me at a civilian party, and if I disappear, I'm automatically, they're like, all my wife has to do, any of my significant others have to do, is there any veterans here? Oh, yeah, it's Chad over there, and he's over, and then to look, and there I'm sitting there talking to Chad. It's just easier. It's just, you have automatically have a huge amount of common ground. So hopefully that works. So find that post. Jade, if you could put that on the VRS page again. I don't think it was actually on. I think we just shared it individually. If you could put that on there, that'd be great. So you could find that petition on the Veteran Radio Syndicate Facebook page, and then go fucking crazy with that shit. You know, a lot of it hasn't made a difference. Some of it has, but you have to keep plugging away with these assholes. You have to. And God is my witness, if I fucking hit that fuck you lottery money, I'm not talking about like the $10 million. I'm talking about the fuck you money. Watch out. I'm going to buy me some fucking representatives and senators. I guarantee you I'm going to get some shit done. But because that's, you know, unless you get a massive grassroots campaign, which is what we're trying to do with this fucking post and we're trying this petition, it's harder and harder. Thank you, Richie, for bringing that up again. I needed that. Josh Miller says, I need help right now cleaning my garage. Dude, you just moved in. How the fuck do you need help cleaning out your garage? You literally closed on your house, what, like 2 months ago? Jesus.
Maybe it's the organizational stage, not necessarily the clean out.
Dean and John agree with me, and John says, yeah, me and my wife calls them big talks. Yeah. All right, so let's go ahead and start off. Again, thanks everybody for tuning in. Please share out the show. I am 2 days away from being unbanned by Facebook for sharing, so we'll see how long that fucking lasts. Probably like 2 weeks if I'm fucking cautious.
I don't even give it that long.
Yeah, probably not. They fucking hate me. Like, I swear to God, I'm on one of their lists. I know I am. They literally made a fucking meme. I think it was fucking J-Dub or somebody made a meme, and it was me poking Zuckerberg with a stick and me poking George with a stick, like Minnie's favorite things. Poking things you shouldn't be poked, but, you know. Fuck them. Like, you know, very soon, we're probably going to switch over, just like BV Nation Radio, over to YouTube exclusively, and I'm gonna start doing podcasts, and I've tossed around the idea of doing a podcast with my wife called The Marine and the Hippie. And so we'll do like an hour of just talking about everything, just like this, except we probably won't be drinking. But, well, I mean, one of us won't be.
Pot smoking, maybe?
That's going to come into it. I'm still talking to a guy who owns a shop up here in my neighborhood. It's a head shop, and I'm talking to him about doing a remote of the bar from his shop. Talking about the benefits of CBD and all that, and Kratom and all that shit to veterans, so, and pimping his store, because I think that's important. Roxanne McKenney. Hey, hold on a second. Hold on. Hey, Roxanne, I want to get your attention real quick.
Nice.
How was your mud facial this morning? Was it good? Is your skin all just flowing and smooth? I mean, mud is good. Mud is good, right, for your facials? Like, that's what they do, you know, not the creep.
Yeah, mud mask.
The natural mud mask, the natural thing. I hear it's very healthy, and it releases your pores, and especially that West Virginia mud. It's just so just earthy. So I hope your facial went well this morning, and we wish you the best here from the bar, myself especially. Mr. George Paros is joining us. What's new? What's happening? What's going on, you big Greek motherfucker?
Not much, man. You know, kind of had a bad day, but as you know, Juicy Smoke Lay says, don't beat yourself up over it.
Oh, Jesus. That's such a fucking dad joke. Oh, I love it, though.
You
good.
Know what?
He got charged again today. I don't know what level. I don't know if it was a state level or what, but he got 6 charges laid against him today or yesterday. For falsifying, well, basically what he did, everything that they can nail him with, they filed against him. But it had to be state level because the county level already, you know, kind of let that go. So I hope that dude goes down hard, like really hard, on a lot of prisoners for a lot of years, because that's where
that
dude belongs.
What it goes to show is that, you know, if that they that the left has got to manufacture outrage, you know what I mean, and that is the one thing that nobody is really pointing out, that if you take a look at the last year, how many manufactured outrages that have been in the United States, you know, that the left has just, you know, had to come up with. You know, you take a look at what happened down in Kentucky with, you know, with those kids, you know, it was manufactured outrage, because again, you know, the left shines on basically, you know, coming up with this victim mentality.
Yes, and, absolutely.
And that's all they have. That is really all they have. And if they don't have it, they've got to come up with it. Because, again, it's – and the funny thing about it is everybody was like, wait a second. You were out at 2:00 in the morning in Chicago and when it's freezing fucking cold? Really?
Yeah. Well, the best and you were was attacked,
and you were attacked by 2 Packers fans?
It was 13 degrees. And oh my God, if you haven't seen Dave Chappelle's latest special on Netflix, you have to check it out. And he says, you know,
Jesse Smollett,
the French actor. And he goes, so you were out at 3:00 in the morning. It was 12 degrees. You're going to get sandwiches? Okay, sir. And who attacked you? A couple of men in mega hats. Where was Kanye West? Check and find out where Kanye West was. It was hilarious. You know, yeah, I can't believe, you know how stupid you have to be to think you're going to pull that off? You've got to be epically stupid and narcissistic. Like, you have to. Because, I mean, a spook would look at that and go, no, that's going to go wrong. That's going to go so wrong.
Well,
and when I say spook, don't fucking jump on my shit. If you see this 20 years later, it's a fucking spy. It's just cooler to say. But yeah, I mean, like, what do you do? No, that's not going to work. They're going to punch through your story. Say what you want about Chicago cops being sometimes most, not the most, some would say not the most honorable and been corrupted by the outfit for about, I don't know, 100 years. But but they are good at what they do. Yeah, modern detective methods are pretty thorough. So yeah, it's unbelievable what that fucking cocksucker did. It really fucking is. I can't believe. And Donna says Donna
I'm
Red.
I'm glad they're
my
fucking
girl.
Going after him. That's bullshit.
Yeah, Donna Red says, and yeah, the right place a victim too. Sure. There's Looney Tunes everywhere, but they're much better at it than we are, and much more fortunate, and much more frequent about it. I agree that, of course, always, everybody's play. It's a go-to now. It's a go-to card. I'm a victim.
A liar's a liar, right or left. They're liars.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. That's I hope he does go down a lot of prison. And he probably will. He could probably make a lot of money for himself in prison. And, you know, you're gay. You might as well just fucking earn. I mean, I guess, right? You know, I mean, ramen noodles are ramen noodles.
He's going to get traded for a lot of damn ho-hos.
Oh, he's a pretty black man. He is for sure. He's a pretty guy. So, yeah, he's going to do well. Dean Cerny says, holy shit, Pardo doesn't have a hat on. This is true. It's the first time I think you've ever been on air in your entire life where you didn't have a hat on, brother. So, you know, hey, Leroy James.
Yeah, I'm just in the basement.
Oh, yeah. And then I just got to get up there now that you fixed it all up and, you know, moved in officially and whatnot. So maybe. Yeah.
Nobody puts Pardos in the corner.
I gotta tell you, I gotta tell you a funny story about my hair because I just took my hat off. And so, I was at a reunion in Vegas a few years ago. One of my buddies came up to me and literally grabbed my because I had the way I had my hair. He thought I was wearing a toupee because you know there are people. You know, I serve with people. I served with people in the Marine Corps that had started going bald like at 25. Oh, you know what I mean? And
I served with guys that were going bald at like 20, 21.
Yeah, I mean, well, there's guys that. But there are people out there that just. Anyway, it was funny. He tried to pull up my, you know, my toupee.
Your luscious locks.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. I'm going to be old. I'm going to get old. I'm going to have all my hair. I'm just going to have dementia and because it runs in my family. So my
yeah, I can't
old friend,
wait for that. I can't wait till I visit you in your bar that I one day hope I could co-own with you in Greece.
In Greece?
Walk up
oh, yeah.
You, walk up behind you and be like, hey, you fucking big fucking gorilla Greek motherfucking ouzo smelling place smashing bitch. And then all of a sudden, Parles puts me through a fucking wall. Like, dude, it's your boy.
We're friends.
What are you doing here? Motherfucker. Hey, I'll be back in a few weeks. I get reconstructive surgery done on my jaw. Thank you very much, you fuck.
By the way, I got to tell you, I don't know if you guys are friends with, something that happened this week. You know, some of you guys are friends with John Fanning.
Yeah.
You know, they broke that record. They were world record holders. Mm-hmm. You know, for rowing across the Atlantic. That is absolutely awesome, man.
Yeah. John's a beast. I met him at Gruntfest 3, and we had a fucking riot. And I have a picture. I'm sure, I don't know, John has not a lot of fucks to give. But it's me and him tonguing, almost. Like this fucking close. And his American flag silkies. And yeah, I had a fucking riot with him. That was one of the funnest ones I've ever been to because I got to hang out with John, who was just right away. It's just a beast. You know, you just gravitate towards certain people who are just like they just have that electricity. And we had so much fun and drank way too much. And it was him, Aaron Hart, Yusha Thomas, combat veteran, Who else? Fucking shit, man. It was insane. It was so much fun. And I think he's still with GS. I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure. But yeah, he's a fucking hilarious individual, and he's a hardcore fucking Marine, dude. He is a hardcore Marine. So I love him to death, and I congratulate him. I've been thinking about trying to ask him to do the show, but if he's still with GS, that might create a an issue. I don't know. Maybe. We'll see. I don't know. You can reach out to him, George. I can reach out to him. I would love to have him on because he is fucking great. He's a great host. He's hosted his own show for a long time. He's a great dude, fun guy to party with.
Yeah, he is. He's a funny dude.
Oh, yeah. He's really goofy.
And a lot of it, too, is that, you know, he's also, he does a lot of good, you know, he does a lot of good things. And it's, you know, so, I mean, again, it is. And one of the other things, that too, that, did you guys get snow today?
No. No, a little really? Sleet, little sleet.
It's snowing here right now.
Well, it's fucking Colorado.
You live in Denver.
It's the Rocky Mountains. Colorado. Oh, it's snowing in February. Weird.
Yeah, right? You guys like it.
Yeah.
I do. I sit in my car waiting for my son and just watch the big snowflakes, and I'm like, it's so pretty. And then I got to deal with all the assholes on the road to get home.
Yeah, but your assholes are way more accustomed to the shit than they are out here.
Not so much the past few years, but...
snows six fucking... Well, yeah, you had a lot of influx of transplants, but still, they learn real quick, they crash, and then they learn real quick, but out here, if it snows... In Cincinnati, if it snows 6-8 inches, the city's paralyzed. It really is because...
But a dusting.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for Colorado, yeah, 16 inches of dusting. Yeah, Donna said she got snow there. Oh, Julie, little spud roommate, what's going on, sweetheart? Donna says your communications are showing on screen. Yeah, Chris is fucking slow, so, you know.
Hey, I gotta tell you something.
It archives it. I don't care if they see it.
Oh, it's all amateur out here. I'm gonna say one thing about Cincinnati.
I wanna say one thing, John, and this is funny. So, I don't know, you know, there's a lot of Germans that settled in both Columbus and Cincinnati also. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that they do is deep fried pork chops.
Oh yeah.
And I'm gonna tell you, if you guys haven't ever tried them, it's a big thing down there. And I'll tell you, you know, one other thing that is, the Reds are the most affordable game in Major League Baseball.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. That is one of the things that makes it pretty cool. I'm kind of bored today. I'm having one of those. I'm having one of those days today. And you saw that the news that broke out of Syria where U.S. forces attacked a Syrian checkpoint and the Russians did nothing.
Yeah. I'm not surprised at all. I mean, they probably were under orders not to get involved. I mean, I don't know. I don't know why, but if the situation was flipped, and if we were up on a checkpoint and some ISIS or whatever rebels attacked a Russian checkpoint and we were within sight of it, let alone radio range of it, you think we would intervene? I doubt it.
I don't know.
I seriously doubt it.
Unless it was that close to us or was a danger to us.
And a lot of things, and I was going to bring this up. I didn't even write it down. I don't know why. I think maybe because I put it in the bar when I was checking for stories. I save shit and I put it in different places for different reasons, and I probably forgot about it. But yesterday, Syrian forces and Russian forces, well, allegedly Russian forces, but for sure Syrian forces, shelled a bunch of Turkish positions. And they did some damage, but they did kind of a expectedly poor job at it. And the Turks had a lot more guns, and so they fired back until they were satisfied. And so now you've got a situation where you've got Russian troops, Russian mercs, Syrian government troops, Iran militia, Turkish troops, Kurds all in one fucking spot with a lot of guns, a lot of heavy weaponry, and somebody's gonna do something stupid. And I don't know what the fuck's gonna happen. I've been thinking this is gonna blow up for fucking a year, but it hasn't yet. And thank God it hasn't. I don't want to be right, but can you imagine if fucking Syria pulls that shit again and Turkey brings in artillery and air and smokes a bunch of fucking Russians again?
I don't know.
What are the Russians gonna do again? I mean, Christ, they share a fucking border, don't they? Like, that's not good. Like, I know Aragon's a fucking psycho. I mean, you know, you go from selling watermelons as your family history to being president of Turkey. It's an accomplishment, but you're still a fucking watermelon seller, so I wouldn't push your luck too much.
Isn't Turkey still technically part of NATO?
It is. Not technically. It is part of NATO.
Oh, that could really be fucked up then.
That's where some of the, I think, a little bit uncalled for, but so, some of the scare was about what's going on over there is, are we going to get dragged in because Turkey does something stupid or Syria does something stupid and they do something back and then the Russians do something stupid and now we're sitting there having to choose whether to defend an ally or not, even though they haven't really been an ally for us in, I don't know.
Who, Turkey? Turkey's never been our ally.
Well, we used to have nuclear missiles based there. That's pretty much an ally. You let somebody put nukes on your soil. I'm sure we pay for it handsomely. You know,
yeah, but you know what? I mean, I still think we ought to. I don't know.
You can't give up on Turkey. You can't long. You got to play the long game with those guys. You have to.
I know. They're sooner or later they're going to wind up collapsing. But you know, what I would do if I was the U.S. I mean, this is why I couldn't be. I literally could not be president. Because my idea of solving some of the problems.
Well, I'm right here, George.
Do what?
I said, you're my right in because you haven't lied to me yet, so I'm going to write you in.
Well, here's the thing. I would solve a lot of problems by throwing people off the cliff, Spartan style. I mean, seriously, I mean, population control would work that way. You know, people that turn left without a blinker, off the cliff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's all right, so let's do this. You put a post out this week that was really funny. It made me think... So, if you were president for a day, I don't know what George is probably going to do, but I'm going to go to Chris first, and then Jade, and then George. You're president, not just for a day, but you become president. Your first action has to be an executive order, and it's all-encompassing. It is enforceable however you want it. You have to create the first – your first action is a nuisance law, okay? And it's punishable by death. Chris, what's your first law? What's your first nuisance law? Punishable by death. I mean, mine will be. If you don't want yours to be, you want to come up creative, go ahead. But mine's death.
People that harm children.
There you go.
We'll just be put to death.
Gonna take care of a lot of priests. I'm good with that.
I mean, seriously, pedophiles?
Yeah.
And you know what? I think what we ought to do is I would Lucille them. Seriously.
You would Lucille them?
You know, and not the bat from The Walking Dead, you know.
Oh, you would Blood Eagle.
Oh my God, I'd be like, batter up. I'm like, this is I mean, seriously, Big Poppy. I mean, the people that would die first in mine would be the people it's close. If you abandon an old dog at the side of the road, you got to die. Seriously, you just
got
to die.
That's how we got Gunny. That's
and he was a puppy, though.
Oh, yeah.
Made it even worse because he's a puppy.
Yeah.
But if you have a dog that you abandon after, like, you have him for 10 years, you kill them. I mean, seriously, you abandon him at the side of the road, you got to kill him.
Yeah, my first arrest ever. Well, it was an arrest. Let's call it my first detainment. I was about 13 years old, and this dude, I was walking my dog with my best friend. I had to walk the dog, and then we were gonna go out and jump on bikes, go to the mall, and go play Mortal Kombat or some shit like that. I can't remember what it was. And this dude just rolled up, jumped out, took this little dog, cute little dog, it was a little bit of a puppy, had him tied on like a wire leash, and started to tie him to a tree. And I'm like, bro, what are you doing? Oh, I can't take care of him anymore. I'm like, don't just bring him over here. Oh, fuck you. I'll do whatever the fuck I want. I just hand him a leash, hand the leash to my friend. I'm like 13. I'm like 90 pounds soaking wet. And I come flying like a missile at this fucking guy. And he's like, what the fuck? And I fucking just hit him. Now, he barely moves 3 inches when I hit him. But I think he didn't expect it. He was on his heels a little bit, and he went down. My buddy tied my dog off, came running over. He was quite bigger than me. He was a hockey player, about 2 years older than me. And he came over and we're beating the shit out of this guy, trying to at least. His girl or whatever whore that you want to call her jumps out of the car, starts beating on us. One of our neighbors comes out, and all of a sudden, like five minutes into it, two Franklin Police Department police rollers roll up, and they jump out and try and separate us. It was a fucking mess, and I had to sit in the back of a cop car for 10 minutes before I was allowed to explain myself. But anyways, they did book him. I don't know what they booked him on, but I think it might have been assault for minor, but I don't know. I have no idea. But yeah, I have a mission in life to pet all the dogs, and so anybody who's cruel to any animal, it's just, you're just a sick fuck. You're a sick fuck. I have to slap, I've raised dogs, raised cats, slap them around a little bit.
And I'm going to say this floor, because
that's nothing compared to abandoning an animal that you've had for years, or abandoning a fucking kitten after. Just, what are you doing? How do you even justify looking at yourself in the mirror? It's a fucking animal, a domesticated animal. How do you leave something hanging like that? You're just a piece of shit. Oh, those people piss me off.
They were stealing people's pets, using them as bait dogs. Then they were burning those, the bait dogs to get rid of the evidence. Yeah. Now, that wasn't a singular thing. Now, imagine if you are a dog owner and your dog was, that your dog is stolen to be used as a bait dog. I mean, seriously, it was that is what you call it. I mean, that's why people are so hard to forgive something like that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, fuck them.
By the way, I got to tell you.
Uh-oh.
I'm watching the primaries, the Democratic primaries. It literally looks like a bunch of drunk Marines in Tijuana on payday weekend. That is how bad it is becoming to look. And Mike Bloomberg,
oh god,
it just held a rally in Virginia, and it turned out to be turned into a pro gun rally. I mean, these guys are. I don't understand the stupidity of. Bernie Sanders just scored a victory in New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand what these people are doing. I mean, seriously, I don't know. And honestly, I've been, I've studied politics for a long time. I've written for a lot of campaigns on both sides of the aisle. I can't tell you what the Democratic message is.
Orange man bad. Free stuff. White people are evil. America was never great. That's their message. How's that? Look, I wanted to bring this up. I forgot to write it down too. It's another one a story that I missed because I wrote down a bunch of shit, but there's only so much I can get to. James Corvo, the Raging Cajun, who is one of my favorite Democrats because he's just fucking entertaining as fuck. He's hilarious. Very smart individual. Very shrewd. Political operative. There's no discounting that. But he's like, I am worried. I was a CNN article that I read. Yes, I read CNN just so I know what the enemy's doing. Which you should do. You should get alerts from CNN, MSNBC, and shit like that. I'm worried. The party has become hijacked by ultra leftist socialist ideals, and all those things sound great, but we have to be a crossover party as Democrats. We have to embrace our base as well as reach independents and some moderate Republicans in order to win. That's what we have to do, and we're not doing it, and I think we're doomed in 2020. And I'm like, that dude's saying that now. That's pretty, because that dude's got his finger on the pulse. That guy's he fucking created Bill Clinton. Nobody knew who the fuck Bill Clinton was before James Carville. Nobody knew. That was the ultimate dark.
That's not true. That's not true.
Outside of Arkansas? Come on, man.
No, because there's a picture of George Bush, George Wallace, and Bill Clinton having a beer at a barbecue way in the 80s. Come on. Let's just be honest.
Bill Clinton, there was a picture out there. Nobody fucking knew who the guy was. Nobody. All right, let's go with 85% of Americans didn't know who the fuck that dude was before he entered the race. Nobody knew who he was. They might have heard the name, but he was a national figure. He was the governor of fucking Arkansas. Granted, the man's a Rhodes Scholar. He's brilliant. He's a bit of a psychopath. Sociopath. But most politicians aren't. The best ones should be locked up. But come on, nobody knew who the fuck that guy was, really. I'm not saying nobody 100%, but come on, no. No. But anyways, you're missing the point. And the point is James Carville worried. He's worried about the party, and he's been a party guy his whole life, and he's saying they're in trouble. So he's either making a call to motivate and jump the base, or he's completely right that they're in trouble, because I don't see anybody that can beat Trump. Warren, fuck off. Biden, he's out in 2 weeks.
Pony soldier, you ugly dog-faced pony. What? I mean, like, how did you come up with this shit?
Who?
It was a John Wayne.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's an old movie.
Yeah.
Old movie quote.
Yeah, did you watch
it? Here's one of the problems with the stuff that's going on right now in the world. It's that we are really, I don't know, we're just fucking stupid. I mean, seriously, it is just an amount of stupidity I've never seen.
Yeah, they have taken identity politics and ran with it and created victimization and ran with it. Give us our votes, we'll take care of your victim status. And they don't. They won't. They don't give a shit. Look, all right, so let's switch gears, but stay sort of on the same topic. Is that Virginia, let's see if I can find my notes. Virginia House approves assault weapons ban. So you've got, I think they're the fourth or fifth state to try and pull this off. Can anybody name a state that's had a comprehensive mental health bill?
A state that has?
Yeah, that's just passing since all these mass shootings.
Connecticut.
Okay. All right. One out of 50. So, or according to Barack Obama, 58, whatever.
Connecticut also leads the nation in the lowest gun crime.
Yeah, because the fucking... nobody fucking lives there, a bunch of rich fucking white people, but anyways.
Well, I understand that, but I mean, seriously, I mean, we've had this debate before.
Yeah.
If you want to have lower gun crime, you have to have the equivalent of being able to put people into institutions against their will.
Yep.
That has worked across the United States. Now, I don't like it, but at the same time, if you're crazy, and a lot of these mass shooters have been crazy and been outed by their family, we need some mechanisms where you can at least stop them, or, you know, put them in till they get help. Because honestly, I mean, here's one of the issues, John, and I want Americans to have guns. I want their guns to own guns. I want to own an A-10 while, you know, with a still in my backyard. That's how, on a scale of liberty, that's how free I want Americans to be. But at the same time, I got to tell you this. Would I want somebody on the range with me shooting table A's with an M60 that didn't know how to shoot?
Oh,
no.
Dude. It wasn't too long ago. I was at the range, and I'm just, you know, I don't own a whatever you want to call it. assault weapon, long gun, whatever. There's my voice crack of the show. Whatever you want to call it. M4, M16A2, M16A1, M14, whatever you want to call it. Whatever the gun it may be. And I was shooting my AK, which is my favorite of all time. I love an AK-47. I love it. And I just was getting done. I pulled my target back to see how I was doing. I was shooting 100-yard range, standing. So I pulled my target back and was a little disappointed. Not terribly, but a little. And this guy looks over to me and says, "Hey, bro, I got this. I don't know what I'm doing." And I'm like, "Oh, well, that's bad." So I fucking roll over to the other bay, and I don't know how he did it, but he got a round jammed and then double feed another one to put it in, and it was just stuck and he didn't know what to do. And I'm like, okay. So I did what the first thing I was taught in boot camp on the range was tap rack bang. So I tap rack banged that motherfucker and cleared it. And I'm like, "Hey, bro, I said, you might want to go on YouTube and look up some things, but if you ever get another jam like that, just tap the magazine, rack the fucking gun, and pull the trigger. If that doesn't work, then come find me again." Because I was just like, I was blown the fuck away. No, it wasn't even long. It was fucking, I think it was Lunchbox was there with me, actually. Like, I had to clear this guy's pistol for him. He had five guns. I have three.
You want to hear something funny?
His gun. Yeah, you, for sure.
You want to hear something funny that's going to be you? You know that they're just. I am so happy I'm out of the Marine Corps that I don't have. And they are moving the Marine Corps from MARSOC, from Camp Pendleton to Lejeune.
What?
Oh yeah, it is. It is absolutely, unbelievable, because I mean, you know, Southern California has, you know, has every kind of place you can think of to train.
Oh yeah.
I mean, and now they're moving them to Lejeune, and I'm like, what the, man. It is unbelievable.
Some general won a fucking pissing contest because California, you have. You have, of course, the SEALs down in Coronado and 32nd Street Naval Station. You have Miramar. You have Camp Pendleton, California, which is one of the largest bases. I think the only one larger is Fort Hood in Texas. And then you go up north, and you've got temperate rainforests. You've got mountains. You got the Sierra Nevadas, where me and George both went to train at Bridgeport Cold Weather Mountain Warfare
is
Training.
29 so. Palms? I thought, isn't 29 Palms bigger than Camp Pendleton?
I don't think. It might be. Well, it's definitely not like building-wise or personnel-wise, but the actual area might be is bigger because there ain't fucking shit there. It butts up right against Joshua National Tree Forest.
I don't understand what they. The size-wise, because I remember being at Camp Wilson, and I remember we had to go. We were at Camp Wilson. We had to go to the Delta Corridor to do the range, and man, it was quite a hump, you know. And I don't know. We ought to look that up and see who's bigger.
Yeah. Jade, get on that. So yeah, me and Josh were going back and forth because he was at my bachelor party and we had a little competition, and we're even on the. On the M1, we're even on the AK, and then we shot the SCAR, which is, oh my god, it's like strapping into a Ferrari.
It is 29 palms. I just looked it up.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shooting the M1 was fucking, oh god. The AK we tied on, the M1 we tied on, but the SCAR, I mean, that's like jumping into a Ferrari for the first time and turning the key, pushing the clutch in, and hitting launch control, and just going. Like, it was just. It looks so big, it is so light, and you can just pop, 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 pop. I mean, it's not much faster than an M4, but it's enough to notice it, and he beat me on that one. But I instantly want to buy one. However, they're like probably, well, they were like $2,700 back then. They're probably maybe like $2,200. It's a super expensive gun. And I just assume get my AK or an M4. But I lost in a shooting contest to a soldier. So, you know, hey, I tip my hat to my mentor. I love him. But yeah, I took it well.
I got to tell you.
With me.
What's that?
Said you haven't shot with me.
Oh, I'll smoke your ass like you're fucking
doubtful, but
oh really? How much you want to put on this? Oh, sorry. So, all right. So I'm going to Guitar
for
Stars.
Well, we're gonna have to figure out logistics. You are going to Guitar.
Yeah. So we'll go to the range and we'll do. We'll see.
Come in a day early. I'm gonna be up there.
We'll do whatever. We gotta find a good range, like a big range. We gotta do indoor range, at least 100 yards. So we can do 25, 50, 75, 100. And then we'll do it with the same rifle, same rounds, same time limit, and we'll see who comes out on top. Cause you are gonna lose. I'm sorry to tell you, I love you to death. You're like my little shin-kicking sister I've never had before, but you're going to lose. Just saying.
We're a pretty damn good shot, especially with rifles.
Did you spend 2 weeks every year in your service learning, working on how to shoot? 2 weeks every year.
Yeah, she did.
I did 8 years
Yeah.
She did more than that.
Oh, bullshit.
No, she did more than that. I guarantee it.
Oh, yeah, from fucking what? 300 yards, Chris? Stop it. Stop. You're going to lose. So we'll discuss this. And unless you want to do it right now, George, you want to back me up on this. You want to put some...
You got it.
Put some...
I believe you. I believe you. I got money on you, John.
Wait.
You've never seen me shoot. Show up.
Listen. Boo-boo. Let me just say this. Guard up.
Did he just call?
Yeah, he called her Boo Boo.
That is the first time ever.
I know.
There's a sign at Paris Island in San Diego. When you go to the range, it says the Marine Corps creates the best marksman in the world. Okay. We had a guy. I'm just going to tell you this. Let's just compare notes. We had a guy that was basically a marksman in boot camp, hit a moving target at 150 yards with two headshots in under 12 seconds with a out-of-date antiquated rifle. And I'm just telling you, you know, they didn't train that at Fort Lee, Virginia, or at, what do you call it, at Fort McClellan, Alabama.
Yeah, well, we're going to do this. We're going to do this Guitar for Stars weekend. We're going to do it. We're going to have a fucking comp.
You also have to understand, too, women tend to have a steadier hand.
Well, I call
so
bullshit.
As far as grouping,
however, I will give you this.
Grouping.
When I worked on the range, some of the best first-time shooters, two of the best first-time shooters were somebody who's never picked up a weapon in their life. And subset of that were females who never picked up a weapon in their life. You know why? Because they listen to everything you fucking told
them.
They listen.
I grew up with rifles and stuff like that, yes, but when I went to basic training, I did, like, I threw out all those habits and stuff like that, and I listened to everything.
Most people don't. Most, yeah, you get Hill Jack from Arkansas.
I had a drill sergeant that said, who's been shooting or been around rifles and stuff like that their whole lives, and you know, whoever raised their hand, he's like, I guarantee you these are going to be the worst shooters.
John Whitmore says, do it with pop-up targets, many will lose. What the fuck is that? I did, you know, the only time I saw pop-up targets was in MCT, which is code for Pogue infantry training. And and then we did a couple times a year I got to go, depending on what unit I was with, got to do George, is probably way before your time, but maybe some of the Army experienced it, the compressed air simulator, the video screens. Did you guys ever do that?
Oh, we had one at the armory.
Okay, yeah, so I got to do that armory with pop-up targets and shit, but... And it was funny, because I think the compressed air kick was actually harder than the M16A2 or the
really?
M4. Oh, I thought it was harder. I thought it was a harder recoil.
I don't think it kicked enough. Well, maybe it was just the machine that we were using. It didn't kick as much.
But I was like, I pulled the trigger, and it would feel... I'm like, what the... What? Okay,
I want to add something that I will give you kudos for the Marines.
Mm-hmm.
I had a drill sergeant. He was not former Marine or anything like that, but during basic training, when we were doing the whole rifles and stuff like that, he said, the Marines do have something right. Your rifle is your lifeline.
Yeah.
So I did have an amazing drill. He was a senior drill sergeant, actually, but...
This is the difference between the Marine Corps and the Army, and then this is the realistic part of it. In the Marine Corps, it takes you longer to get to the rifle range.
Oh yeah.
And so the first part of Marine Corps boot camp is on how to become a Marine. The rifle range isn't part of that. Where in the Army, you start, weapon familiarization much earlier. And that is one of the reasons why the Marine Corps and the biggest difference between the Marine Corps and Army boot camp is that in the Marine Corps, you wait to go to the rifle range, where the Army teaches you how to be a war fighter earlier. Mm. Now, that is one of the biggest things. Now, one of the other differences too is that the Marine Corps shoots to 500 meters, and that's a
quarter mile.
That's a lot of And I qualified.
What's the scariest thing?
Do you guys use iron sights? You guys don't use.
Well, we used to.
I qualify with iron sights.
I was iron sights. Yeah, I was iron sights.
I tell you the story. I've said the story before. I had two things I had a hard time with in boot camp. The first one was. It was standing to sitting, where you had because you have the sling around your arm, and I had this, and our PMI was this little Filipino dude. He was like 5'5", 5'6", kind of like Chris, little garden gnome, and so
poor Chris.
He would yell at us. I mean, and. The first time I went from standing to sitting, after I got to the fleet, I got a chance to adjust, and I had some, better instruction on how to adjust the sling. I looked like one of Jerry's kids. I literally went from standing to sitting, and the worst thing I did is I almost had the flash suppressor hit the dirt. So I landed, and I'm getting yelled at by everybody.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And my, and then we get back to when we got back to the barracks that day, my drill instructor was, sat down. He's like, what is wrong with you? And we made a couple adjustments, but man, they had, I couldn't get comfortable in that position. So in boot camp, I came out as a sharpshooter, and I shot like I think it was either 215 or 216. It wasn't until I got... Seriously, dude, I could not...
You barely made a sharpshooter. You barely made it.
It did, because I couldn't get
it.
I never
had to qualify in the sitting position.
It used to be. Marine Corps shooting used to be, and they've changed it a bit, but you would do, from 200 yards, you do sitting, kneeling, standing. Then you do... Prone, you do rapid fire, then you go to 300 yards, you do kneeling and prone rapid fire.
But you guys never had the pop-up targets?
No. Different... Well, I mean, yes, they popped up, but you did George will know this. Shooters on the range.
Ready on the right, fire when your targets appear.
And then they would pop up, and then boom, that's when you go. And it was, and you sitting there like trying to control yourself. Well, I learned after a couple of years to try and control my breathing and my pulse, because that's huge. But
sing,
But you know, they make.
I'm
it
not
up
gonna
in the
give
pen.
you
It's
any more
great.
pointers.
But it was fun. And I loved going on the range.
Control
I
your
loved it
breathing.
So much they fucking
Sing.
Put me on the range. So, as a coach, as a fucking range safety, as a fucking I worked there for several months just doing bullshit work, and it was one of the funnest times I've ever had in my life because I was surrounded by grunts and combat arms guys, and I was billeted with them over on main side, and those were the funnest. Because you're at work at like 4:30 in the morning, or at least getting up, but you're off at like 1 o'clock, 1:30 at the latest. So you've got a lot of day drinking to do. So and then get up for PT at 4, run, do your PT, then go to the range and watch a bunch of Marines try not to fucking fuck
so,
shit up.
So Minnie, I want to ask you a question. Does this challenge of ours, does this include pistols?
Oh, some fucking asshole talked shit to you, didn't he?
No, no, it just, like, it hit me. I'm curious, because...
Alright, so, we're gonna have to come up with something,
we just get it...
because I'm not the greatest pistol shot in the world, but, and you might be, so we'll have to go, we'll figure out a way to go 2 for 3, because I'm winning one of them. I don't think I'll win the pistol one. The furthest I've shot is 25 yards, which is probably all, as far as you should try and shoot a pistol, unless you're desperate. So we'll have to come up with a third round, like some way, or like skew it point wise. I don't know. We'll come up with something though. It's in May, so we've got some time. But
we got
I
some
am
time
not
to
the
figure
greatest
this
pistol
out.
Shot.
But I was curious because
I
not
get,
everybody.
If we do
and
piss-
that was actually one of my downfalls was like I grew up with rifles and stuff like that, but then like the whole pistols and stuff like that. I'm like barely qualifying on the pistol. But then when I started training up with my unit to go overseas and stuff like that, having civilian police officers training me to do pistols and stuff like that, I became more comfortable with it. The M9 fucking sucks.
Oh, yeah,
it's
a stupid pistol.
And I'm glad to hear that they're phasing that out. But I was out of curiosity so I can...
By the way,
refreshing my skills.
I've got $200 of fucking range time fucking gift cards, so I'm gonna
I don't even have to go
study.
To the range. I just gotta go to the cabin.
Yeah, well, you suck.
You know, I tell you what.
You love it.
I know
about the Marine Corps now is that the Marine Corps is starting to get They're talking about getting the Marine Corps down to 184,000 Marines.
Well, our congressional mandate used to be 175,000, but it was up to almost 230,000 during the peak during GWAT. So I'm not surprised that they're scaling down a little bit. So they're going to drop 2,000 active duty Marines this year. So I'm not surprised. I was kind of waiting for it actually for a minute when they're going to start doing like. Because they had dropped a bunch, but it's been a minute since they have, so I'm not surprised. I mean, they've got to cut them. I mean, payroll's the most expensive thing in the world, so I'm not surprised. And unfortunately, a lot of good Marines aren't going to get fucked. And I don't talk about like good Marines, like poster boy Marines. I'm talking about war fighters who've been there, done that, done 2 or 3 tours, and have an amazing amount of experience passed down to younger Marines and boot Marines. Those are the guys you need to hold on to, not the fucking pretty boy fucking guys who never got a fucking Article 15, did no tours overseas, or did one and they sat in a comm tent for fucking 12 months. Those are the guys you don't want to keep on. Get rid of those guys. Keep the fucking infantry guys. Keep the grunts. Keep the tankers. Keep the mortarmen. Keep those guys. Get rid of the male guys. Get rid of the intelligent guys. Get rid of the fucking guys we don't need. That are super important for the long game.
But here's the problem. I mean, here's the problem with it. You can always. I mean, don't take this. You know, but you can always recruit grunts.
Yeah, you can't recruit experience.
Right. I mean, that's one of the problem. One of the problems that you have, and especially with the Marine Corps, is that, you know, when you were in the 80s, one of the problems that you have is. You know, a lot of the guys that we had, I saw one, maybe one or two, three, you know, what first year, you know, first enlistment sergeants, but for the most part, they hardly ever made it there. Yeah. The biggest thing was we had cutting scores in the Marine Corps when I was, you know, when I was in of 1800, 1850 for some jobs.
Oh, yeah.
And that drives people out.
Dude, my MOS was like in the upper 2300s for a minute, and then it crashed because they froze it for so long. Marine Corps made me a corporal.
Here's the thing that when I was at Quantico, I had a chance to reenlist, right? And in 88, they had the Graham-Rundman bill, which separated a lot of Marines early. Man, they cut away a lot. And one of the things that happened, the only reason they kept me on, I represented the Marine Corps in the 1988 Olympic trials. As soon as we were done, we got, most of us got out, and that was in June. They had so many Marines like separated out that year. It was unbelievable the amount of that they dumped. And you know, they had guys from, you know, the fleet. You know, they had, you know, guys from, I tell you who else took a big hit in 88, that, because they went away from them, were tankers and Motor T. Oh. Those guys just, they dumped.
Love my tankers. Love them. If you don't walk up to an M1, A1, which is, they have M1, A1. I can't remember the version of it. It's updated computer optics and all that other shit. If you don't walk up to one of those and don't get a freedom boner, I think there's something wrong with you. Those things are fucking beautiful. They are so awesome.
If I ever win the lotto, I'm buying me an M1, A1.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude.
Seriously, and even if I, you know what? And even if I don't make the payments, what are you going to do? I got to pay.
Well, it's not probably not firing if you can buy it. Although we can retrofit it.
You can buy a tank. Hey, listen, the military industrial complex, they'll sell you anything.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. Go ahead.
So the other thing I want to talk about, too, is that, you know, kind of it was really kind of heartbreaking this last week, if you don't mind. The two special forces guys that got killed on
the insider attack in Afghanistan. Yeah.
Yeah.
Blue that was green.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I talked about this before, but I think where PTSD has really, really, really reared itself. And yes, guys in World War II had it. Guys in Korea had it for sure. But I think the big percentage jumped up. Vietnam, it jumped up huge. Because the difference between Vietnam or World War II, Korea, was you had, for the most part, some lines. You knew where the enemy was, and you were, as an American, soldier, Marine, Airman, Navy SEAL, what the fuck ever, you were on prey mode, for the most part. Until,
what do you mean?
It's easier to deal with doing what you do when you're the predator than it is when you're. I misspoke earlier. It's easier to be the predator than the prey, and I think lately with asymmetrical warfare with Afghanistan, with Vietnam definitely started, but Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq. Initially, it went very well, but then after a while, it became. We stopped being the predators and we became the prey. We went out looking for trouble, trying to find it, and then using what we've always used, which is make contact with the enemy, maneuver, call in superior firepower, and dress. But you still have to make contact. And every time you make contact, people are going to die. And you know that, and so it fucks with your head because nobody likes to be prey. It's a scary fucking feeling, and that's where hypervigilance comes in. Hypervigilance comes in, and that's where PTS has exploded. Now, if you look at, like, even Vietnam, you look at First Gulf War, Second Gulf War, Afghanistan, all of a sudden, shit started turning to... We would go out and look for them. We go out and look for them and wait for them to hit us.
You're also fighting... an ununiformed force.
Right. It's
You're also you don't have the battle lines, you know.
Look at the numbers though in the days of deployment. The average World War II combat soldier, okay? This is coming from DOD. Served roughly between 57 to 65 days a year in combat. Okay? Yeah. That's what they serve. Number two, the Vietnamese veteran that served 255 days in combat.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then you can't even compare, you know,
because that was a turnover because they got smoked so frequently.
Well,
that made it, they were rapidly promoted because they fucking had to find somebody to lead shit. But the point is, it's predator versus prey. Do you want to be the predator or do you want to be the prey? Most people want to be prey. That's why if you look at, even in GWAT, if you look at, like, Rangers, if you look at SEALs, if you look at Marine Corps Force Recon, you will find that the PTS rates are significantly lower. They're significantly lower than regular line infantry in the Marine Corps or the Army because they're predators. Tier one operators, they go out and they go find the bad guys and they smoke them.
Yeah, they have more control. Right. Which, that, you know, PTSD or PTS or however you want to say it is actually classified as an anxiety disorder.
Well, it is.
Well, anxiety, you know, the fear of the unknown, the future, hypervigilance, like you had mentioned before.
It rewires your brain. Completely rewires your brain.
People who were stuck on a fob are more likely to suffer from PTS than somebody who's like in an operator status, like you were saying. Because,
yeah, but
you know,
fuck me up if I'm jerking off to fucking Alexis, Texas, and all of a sudden the mortar fucking sirens come off. Yeah.
Sitting ducks versus hunters, you know?
Mm, right, but a lot of it is too, is that the fact that, you know, during. I don't want to be whataboutism, but, you know, during the Obama administration, you know, the rules of engagement were different. You know, he had, you know, so, you know, you kind of are not, you don't have a faith in command like you know, like they have under Trump or under, you know, Bush. I mean, that was a big complaint of a lot of troops over there. Part two is also the fact that that when you're sitting there looking at the type of combat that they are, as the war progressed, IEDs took off.
Yeah.
And
Our armor had to change. Our vehicles had to change.
And Afghanistan, and for the most part, this is something that isn't, you know, spoken to. Afghanis, for the most part, were not. This is going to be a long. I'll put the short version.
Go ahead. I'll be
right. Afghanistan. What the people of Afghanistan were not. They, in their form of Muslim religion, they never suicide bombed themselves until the war. the same thing with Iraq. Prior to the Iraqi war, there was never not one case of a suicide bomber in Iraq. It's not part of their culture. It's just like the Indonesians do not believe in fatwas. That Muslim part is not in there. That's not the way they worship Islam. And so part of the problem that they had was once the suicide bomber, car bombs, IEDs started to go off, it really changed warfare. And it became a much different battlefield. And the one thing that usually is not, I don't know, if it's not being brought up, it should be, but Afghanistan has never, they don't have a unifying voice other than we want to be Afghanistan, you know, we want to be Afghanistani. We just hate everybody else, you know, and it is, it's like the Hatfields and the McCoys. We don't care, you know, we just want to have we want to fight each other. We would just prefer to fight you, but if not, we'll fight each other. I think one of the problems has been with my solution to Afghanistan would have been solved in 5 years.
What's that?
I'd have sent every person that we grabbed on the southern border and we had to deport, I'd send them over to Kabul.
You know, I was thinking about this earlier today. You know, I have a neighbor, a very good friend of mine, named Fred. I call him Freddy. He's the son of a French Foreign Legion officer. He's hilarious. And it made me think today about the Foreign Legion. It is basically composed of, it's basically, I'll say about regiment or two regiments strength, depending. I don't know. I haven't checked in on it in a long time since I almost joined it when I got divorced.
The French Foreign Legion? Yeah. No, they've got 25,000 troops.
Okay, so it's almost a division.
I think.
Almost American division. But it's supposedly made of all foreigners. And I wonder if you did something like, could you even remotely pull something like that off here? So wow. You want to come to this country? You want to come to this country?
9,000. You have 9,000.
I know we have pass for immigrants to become citizens through the military, but what if it was a guaranteed fucking thing? Well, you form a complete division called the American Foreign Division, and if you want to become a citizen of the United States, you have to join this unit, like the French Foreign Legion, and you could be from fucking fuck all everywhere. But as long as you learn English, which the French, they don't give a fuck where you're from, the French Foreign Legion. You can be from goddamn Angola. You can be from fucking Sumatra. You can be from fucking Prince George Island. You sign up. You have to learn French. And you will learn French. And if you fuck up and they ask you something in French, they beat the brakes off of you. But they have managed to make one of the most toughest military organizations in the world. I put them on par with the Marine Corps charge. They are nasty individuals. They are tough as fuck. Could you do that here? Could you do that in America?
Why couldn't you? We did it.
Because we're such a soft fucking country. We're so soft.
We've done it twice before. We did that. I mean, we had, up until 19. I'll find out the year, but in the 80s. In the 80s, they used to be able to enlist into the Navy from the Philippines and get guaranteed citizenship. That was a program, and I don't know when they dropped it, but I know that they have. But that was one of the things. You were able to go into the, you know, you were able to if you're Filipino, you're able to go in there and join, and you were guaranteed citizenship. And now they stopped that program, but it was a very decent program. That's why you had so many Filipinos that were in the Navy.
Yeah, I wonder why I met so many Filipinos at 32nd Street Naval Station. All right, hold on.
But I don't see why not. I mean, seriously, let's say this. If you were to...
Because the left would come up and say, oh, you're exploiting minorities and immigrants. It's like, well, guess what? You know
you don't want to fight?
One of the backbones of the fucking... one of the backbones of a lot of military, especially the Roman military, was the auxiliaries. You know what the auxiliaries were? They were immigrants the Romans recognized after they beat them. They could fight like bastards. So they
lost a whole legion into Germany because one of their legionnaires went rogue.
Three legions.
Wow. Okay, you know what I was talking about.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, Varus, Augustus screaming, Varus, where are my legions? And I can't remember the name of the guy. It started with an L. He was a auxiliary, became a Roman officer.
But Longinus.
Something like that. He's from German descent, and he betrayed and helped destroy three Roman legions with, I don't know the numbers, but I'm guessing what the damage he did monetarily wise was probably in the order of probably like $100 million.
Nice.
Because it costs a lot of money to field three legions. A legion is, it costs a lot. Labor is everything.
Legion was about 10,000. It was Legion was about
10,000 men. Yeah, depending on how many auxiliaries you had. But yeah, So it was a shit ton of money. We might have a very special guest join us here very soon. I'm trying to figure out when he's going to freaking go.
By the way, what do you think about the coronavirus?
It's bullshit and it's stupid. I don't understand why people are freaking out about it. I don't get it. Yeah, it's another virus.
It's understandable. It's understandable. It's a virus and everything else.
Flu kills more people every fucking year than
and
this
I told
flu has
you
gone.
That shit.
Yes. Yes.
Because the flu does.
How many people fucking
listen, Linda?
Listen, Linda. Oh, hold
what
on.
What I'm trying to say is like the whole panic behind it is bullshit.
Hold on, I'm trying to add somebody. You know, keep talking though.
Okay, so the whole panic behind it and stuff like that. This whole like it's again, I'll even say the word again. It's fear-mongering. It's like we freaked the fuck out over Ebola the same way that we're freaking out about the coronavirus. People are saying like my mom has been a registered nurse 20 plus years now. Well, yeah. 20 plus years now, and she's just like, I don't get why people are so freaked the fuck out. People are saying
it's stupid. Because you know what it is? It's because it's new. It's new. We don't know what's going on.
Yeah,
it's...
but the flu, honestly, has killed more people every fucking year.
Yeah. Hey, Mr. President? Mr. President, are you here? Are you with us? Or are we doing this? Hold on. There it is!
Uh-oh.
Thank you, everybody. Hello.
Oh, I love it. Let me get you.
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
What's going on, Mr. President? How you doing?
Doing all right. How you doing? Good to see you the back end.
Are you going to do video, or do you just want to do audio? If you want to do audio, that's fine. No, you're a very busy man.
Audio for right now because I am naked laying on my couch, so I don't want you to see that.
Oh, when you have a supermodel wife.
Well, yeah, you should be naked a lot of the time. Mr. President, it hasn't been that long, but let me congratulate you on your acquittal in the impeachment trial. That was awesome. I loved it. It was great theater. I'm almost happy it happened. I don't know about you, but I was almost happy it happened because I really think it torpedoed the Dems' chances for 20. I think you're going to win in probably the biggest landslide since Ronald Reagan. What do you think about that?
I really think it's going to be true. Nancy Pelosi, that little crooked son of a bitch, she doesn't know anything else. Listen, the Democrats deal with the fate whenever they lost. I won New Hampshire primary yesterday. It is fantastic. All blue. It's going to be fantastic. We are coming in nice. We're going to come in and destroy the entire United States with a landslide.
Awesome. I love it. I love it. Were you ever nervous during this thing? I mean, they were coming at you pretty hard, man.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. I really enjoyed it. I was laughing the whole time. It was good entertainment. Me and the White House staff would sit here and watch the TV like, ha, those fucking retards.
Chris Cornell, you got a question for President Trump. I mean, Trump, he's a libertarian, and I admit, Mr. Trump, I'm a conservative libertarian, if that means anything, but Chris, he's a good guy, he's a libertarian, he likes limited government. I think you like limited government, but he's going to ask you a serious question, so Chris, go for it.
Well, from the State of the Union, there were a lot of what appeared to be the big spending projects announced. I'd just like to know, where are you going to find the money for this?
We're going to find the money from, we have a lot of money stored away in the Federal Reserve. It's going to be a lot of money, a lot of, China owes us a lot of money anyways, a lot of China. China owes everything. They started the coronavirus, we already know that, and we're helping them out, so guess what? You owe me big, big bucks, China.
I love it. I love it. Good answer, Mr. President. So now you've been cleared from impeachment, which is only the third time it's ever happened. You come out smelling like roses. What's next, Mr. President? What's next for the President of the United States? I mean, besides 2020, besides your eventual election for a second term, what's next? What do you do with the last moments of your second term? What do you do?
The last moments of my second term or first term?
Term. Sorry. I got excited. I thought maybe they might just, revoke that amendment in the Constitution and give you a couple more. But yeah, go ahead.
It is possible. Trump 2024 as well. You know, but wouldn't that be awesome?
I thought your daughter was going to run in 2024.
She might, or my son. It'll be Trump all the way, and then barely in 2035. Be Trump.
Hey, the first woman president could be Ivana Trump. Ivana, your daughter, who is awesome, very eloquent, very intelligent, and, by the way, a little hot, if you don't mind me saying.
She is very, she's really intelligent. Let me just say that the president of the United States, we're going to win the second term. We're going to keep making America great. It's going to be fantastic. There's going to be no other thing like this. The Democrats are going to cry. Nancy Pelosi's going to offer herself, thank God, and we're going to just have a good time.
Hey, Mr. President, there was some very big controversy on your State of the Union address, and it really didn't necessarily surround around what you said, as I don't think a lot of people, left or right, could argue with what you said in the speech. But however, you did refuse to speak refuse to shake the hands of Nancy Pelosi, and then at the end of the speech, she shredded your speech. What was that all about?
Well, that's the hand she wipes her cunt with, so I don't want to go to that thing. And about ripping up the speech, I have no idea. She was just a little crying 2-year-old, just like she always is. She didn't get her way. She knew she wanted to impeach me, but it didn't even work. Since day one, Nancy Pelosi, all she wanted to do is impeach the president, which, too bad, so sad, bitch. I won, you did not. Go to hell.
You're a beast. You're a beast, Mr. President, and I love you, and I always appreciate you coming to the bar. George Parros, you got any questions for the President of the United States?
No, not really. He's the first Scotsman to be president in, a couple hundred years, so
yeah,
it's kind of happy.
Another Catholic. You can't. Well, he wasn't. He's not a Catholic. But, Jade, you've been laughing and chuckling and laughing. You got something for the President of the United States? Come on, man. We got the President of the United States on. You got shit to fucking ask him?
I'm in fangirl shock.
Oh, there you go.
Mr. President, can you make a executive order that only Marines graduating from Paris Island are real Marines?
Oh, motherfucker! Oh, no, Mr. President, you can't do that. Because you know why, Mr. President? They don't know what a fucking mountain looks like.
All
right.
Oh, my God, that's all you have.
Yeah.
We have a mountain. We got a hill.
A hill? No, they're mountains, motherfucker. Hey, they're literally on the fucking mark. Mountains. If you do 20 miles, on flat ground, that ain't shit. It's 20 miles, but you're 20 miles with mountains.
That's all you have.
Fine. That's all we have.
We have alligators in a slide for life.
Mr. President, can you weigh in on this?
Listen. I love my Marines. You guys are all the same. But the one thing I am going to do is delete the Air Force and bring back the Army Air Corps.
Because yes!
The Air Force is...
Oh, shit. I just got my vote.
Because we all know the Army's going back to the World War II uniforms, so we're going to bring back the Army Air Corps because it makes sense. It's more badass that way. Bring back the original logo and everything, the original uniforms, but not obviously the same bombers. That'd be weird. But, have the same bombers, everything, but screw the Air Force. We're going to get rid of the Air Force. Just call it the Army Air Corps.
I like it. I think it's slimmer. I think it would actually save money, Mr. President. I think that would be a good thing to sell to, Congress is like, hey, I'm combining forces and I'm saving money. Now, we got the Space Force, which you created. That's awesome. Now, Mr. President, I know you're a well-read guy. You're an amazing businessman. You're great, a weirdly great politician. You never wore one until you got elected to the President of the United States, which is hilariously weird. But what do you think? Do you watch a lot of TV? Have you ever watched a lot of Amazon Prime? Have you ever seen the series called The Expanse?
No, I have not. Never seen that
before.
You need
to check it out. You need to check it out, Mr. President, because you initiated Space Force. You need to check it out. It's a very cool show about what's going to happen when the United States of America dominates space, when we go to the moon, we change the name, we go to the belt, we start mining asteroids, and it creates a whole different kind of classes of people. You have Earthers, you have Lunars, you have Mars, you have Belters. It's very cool, very cool.
Listen, I will say, though, we have discovered oil on Uranus, so we're going to go straight there. We're going to extract the oil as fast as we can. Also, Mars. lots of oil. We're going to build a big infrastructure on Mars. We're going to have the first military base on Mars. We're going to have missiles. Iran won't be there. We're going to invade Mars. Those Martians have no chance. They're going to see weapons.
The Army Space Corps could do it.
The Space Corps could do it. We are building a Death Star that has so much power it can destroy a planet. And we're going to wipe North Korea off the face of the map.
Mr.
President, I actually do have a question for you. It came from a loyal listener. How much did you actually pay Stormy Daniels?
I plead the fifth.
I love it. Good call, Mr. President. Look, we're looking to the future. Yes, it's, a few months before November. In my opinion, Mr. President, I'm not kissing your ass, because I never would, and you would, if I did, you wouldn't like it. But, any challenges coming in 2020? Anything you see that's going to maybe hiccup you?
Well, obviously the Democrats in the next month are probably going to plan up some bullshit on me again, like, oh, Donald Trump took a shit the wrong way, we're going to impeach him again. Like, this is going to happen. So every other month it's something. Last year it was Russia. This year was the impeachment hoax. Next year will probably be, like I said, Donald Trump took a shit and wiped it on a little girl. I don't fucking know. It's going to come out like some weird shit. The Democrats are fucking weird. That's why I got to watch what I say, because they're going to come out with some weird shit and try to impeach me. I don't like it.
Yeah, how tough is it to, what? I got to ask you. I don't think I've ever asked you this, Mr. President. And we've been talking before you became president. And I didn't never ask you this, really, honestly. I never did. I asked you your policies. I asked you this, that, and the other thing. But why in the flying fuck did you want to become president? And why the fuck do you want to do a second term? Like, seriously, what is wrong with you? Like, well, why do you want that attention?
There's a lot wrong with me, but then again, I am Donald Trump. Look, when I saw America in shambles after Barack Hussein Obama, I wanted to make America a lot better. Yes, I said Hussein. Listen, I saw America in shambles, and I'm just going to run. And I said, you know what? I might have a chance of doing this. And I did it before 2012. I can do it again. And look, I won. Everybody thought I wasn't going to win. CNN, fake news, said I wasn't going to win. I won. MSNBC, ABC, I won. And guess what? They're all crying now. Their ratings. You know what? When I'm not president anymore, the ratings are going to tank, because I'm entertainment for them. I'm like an actor in the White House. The CNN, once I leave the presidency, their ratings will go right back down the drain. That's all they are. They feed off of what I do.
Mr. President, we had a great, great, great statement in the comments for our show. I think you'll appreciate it. It's from Julie Little Spud Romaine. I think you should take note of her, because she's an amazing, amazing woman. She said, quote, "If you were married to someone that looked like Melanie, would you waste time watching TV? LOL." Of course not. Of course not. You're married to one of the most beautiful women in the world. You can take a lot of shit, right? Just coming home and looking at her and going, yeah, fuck it. I'm good.
Oh, I get it every night. Don't worry about it. That's why you think I'm not stressed at all about this impeachment bullshit. During the Soviet Union, I was getting the BJ underneath the stands. I mean, fuck, I don't know.
Police Academy style?
Damn straight. all my speeches, why do you think I'm so happy all the time? Why do you think the podium's covered up for? Wink, wink.
Jesus Christ. George, you got anything for the president?
Nope, that's it.
Oh, come on, George. You got to have something.
I don't. He's answered all my questions. All right, Chris. You know why they're not going to have Marines in the Space Force? Because they're going to be like Rockhound. Rockhound on the movie Armageddon. He's going to go up in space and do stupid shit and then go, I owe $100,000 to a fat-ass loan shark, which I spent on a stripper named Molly Mountain.
No. It's going to be the Navy, and I hope the Navy wins this. When we go to space, I hope the Navy wins this. I really do.
Listen. The Marines are going to go up to space, and they're going to fuck up and fuck a space hooker and get galactic chlamydia. And the next thing you know, there's galactic chlamydia everywhere around the galaxy. So we're going to have a galactic STD epidemic, and we're going to be like, oh, what'd you do? Fuck that stripper at Tatooine? Oh, yeah. I was in that cantina. Now look at your dick. It has three heads down instead of one. Good job, dumbass.
All right, Mr. Trump, look, let's admit, like, if we go to space, it's going to be the Navy, and then, of course, we're going to need Marines. But let's backtrack, and in our time, who's going to handle the nastiest, nastiest shit? What do you think is the nastiest shit out there? I'll give you a hint. What the fuck's going on with Syria and Turkey? They're getting into some serious shit. What are you thinking about that, Mr. President? Like, that's a NATO ally getting involved with I wouldn't call it a Warsaw Pact ally, but a Russian ally. Like, that could get really nasty. What are you thinking right now? I mean, you're getting briefs from the NSC in the Situation Room that Turkish soldiers are getting killed by Syrians and Russians, and Syrians and Russians are getting killed by Turks. What are you going to do about that mess? It's a mess, sir. What are you going to do?
Listen, there was an incident today, I don't know if you guys saw it, where American soldiers were ambushed by pro-Syrian.
Right, I heard that too, yeah.
And Russians were sitting there looking with their hands folded and watching. But let me tell you, Russia, we ain't going to take your shit. So you want to sit here and fry turkey, we'll fry back. It's all good.
So you want to back Turkey?
Well, Turkey is an ally. Syria, we're going to just use one.
Yeah.
Kind of. They're just there for publicity. Anyways, so we're going to use a bunch of Moabs, and we're going to destroy Syria, and Al-Assad, Ali, Daka, Durka, Durka is going to go bye-bye.
I like that. I like that, Mr. President.
Hey, listen. I got to head out of here. I got something to do real quick. Anyway, I appreciate being on the bar again. It's always a pleasure with you guys. I really hope you guys have a good time. Sometimes I make an appearance on Saturday night at the Blackout Lounge when, you know, I'm drunk as fuck.
Absolutely. Please check that out. Blackout Lounge every Saturday at 2200 Eastern Standard Time with Traegs, Lil Lopez. Every once in a while, President Trump, a.k.a. somebody we don't know, a.k.a. sometimes the Salty Seaman. It's a great show, one of the funnest, just loosest shows ever. I know President Trump tunes into it all the time.
I watch it every Saturday when I'm flying at Air Force One. I get drunk with me, too. Even the pilots bring beer with me. It's a good time.
There you go.
All right, guys. You guys have a good show. Talk to you guys later, okay?
All right. Thank you, Mr. President. I always love you having on, man, brother. You keep on keeping on.
Stay American.
Fucking A right, doggy.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I just say bye-bye to the president.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Oh, I got my retard dance monkey voice.
Bye-bye. Yeah. We're going to do that next week. We're going to make Jay do her dance monkey voice next week.
It's her normal voice, John.
It's a little bit different.
Bullshit, we're doing it now.
Oh, my God. What else did I want to fucking get into this night? There was something that was pissing me off. Oh! No, that's not really good enough. Oh, yeah, this is funny.
You know what? I got to tell you this. If you ever feel bad about yourself.
Yeah.
Just if you really seriously, if you really feel bad about yourself, there's a Navy SEAL by the name of Johnny Kim, who was a Navy SEAL sniper, then went to Harvard and finished medical school and is now an astronaut. So if you didn't feel bad about yourself,
thanks for the help, you fucking prick. Question.
He just ruined the bar for everybody.
Yeah.
Seriously. I mean, every Korean family out there, why can't you be more like Johnny Kim? Not only was he a SEAL, but he's a doctor and an astronaut.
Well, George, don't you think this is very much, and tell me I'm wrong, but this is a very, very common thing amongst immigrants, the immigrants that came over here, is they would fucking insanely kill their kids.
He hasn't done enough.
To fulfill their American dream. You have to kill at school. You have to, which I think it should be across the board, but they're very good at it. Immigrants have always been about the belief
in America.
You're a
doctor, but not a
surgeon. You work hard, you put your ass to the ground, you kill yourself to get ahead, and guess what? You get ahead. That's the American dream.
When I went to Ohio State.
George, you're the American dream. George, you are. You're a fucking immigrant.
I know, but hold on. Let me tell you this fucking story because it's fucking great. So I had this kid, a Chinese kid, in the math class. And we were in calculus 302. And it's a fucking hard class. And me and him had both number one and number two grade. And one time, we get our midterm back, and he says, I got a Chinese F on the test. I'm like, what the fuck is a Chinese F? He got an A-. And he was, I was like, dude, seriously? And we had, and it was so funny because we had this other kid in there that was Nigerian. And he was from, of all the things, he was from the Igbo tribe in Nigeria. And this guy was fucking brilliant. And
it was one of my girlfriends in college.
And this guy was just absolutely, so we had the one, we had, I finished third in the class, but these guys, partly because I was also wrestling and, you know, I was, you know, I actually got laid in college, like I leave these guys.
Weird.
You know.
You got laid in college. That's so hard to do.
I know. Especially when I was the oldest student athlete at Ohio State that year. So that wasn't too hard.
That didn't hurt at all.
But it was so funny because I was like the token athlete in the class, and everybody was kind of like making fun of me because like everybody in there looked like a Chris Cornell reunion.
Poor Chris. I mean,
sounds glorious.
Sounds glorious. Good for you, Chris.
I could outbench the whole class. I mean, that was even if they added their weight, what they could bench, I could outbench the whole class. That's how bad it was. And
those are fun classes, though.
Oh, it was. And, you know, I'd come in and, we would do things in there like differential equations. And we would do data, you know, a lot of, with calculus, a lot of data sets. And a lot of it was, you know, and I got to tell you this. This is what, in all honesty, this is what scares me. We did a problem in 1992 that I thought would never get solved. Okay. It was a theorem. It was the square, you know, it was 33, three numbers to add squared to add up, or, you know, to get to 33. And they finally solved it this year or last year with a computer that did it in 21 days.
Oh, Jesus.
Now, the reason that it, and I mean, it doesn't seem like a big deal.
No, it is a big deal.
But here's one of the, you know, here's one of the problems that we've got to address with technology is there are going to be times now that encryption, even with 128-bit encryption, we are going to wind up not being able to keep things.
Quantum theory is coming a long way. Quantum security is going to come a long way too. So it's always been an arms race, and it's going to continue to be one. But yeah, once a lot of people get some quantum theory going on as far as like security and how to do that, yeah, what we thought was secure yesterday is going to be gone. So it's going to be an arms race. It's always going to be an arms race. I'm just interested in the fact that, are we going to survive that arms race? Are we going to do what I think we need to do to survive as a human species and go to space? Because that's the only thing I think we're going to survive with. Because if we don't do that, we're going to be fucked. Because medical technology is advancing too fast. And because of that, people are breeding too fast. And eventually, we're going to run out of water. We're going to run out of fucking a lot of shit. So we have to ship people out to space.
We're not going to run out of that. I mean, realistically, the Earth could hold about 50 billion people.
I don't know. I don't believe it too much, George.
No, because if you have, I mean, think about this. I mean, how much food, America could make enough food to feed 800 million people. I mean, America, you go to Nebraska, and Nebraska...
solve the next 7.1 billion people. Like, I mean, we're only at, like, what? When I say this, we're only at 5.5. I'm just going to go with this, and we're going to final thoughts. Bill Boris, one of my favorite comments, says, we're in need of a fucking a pandemic. We're in need of one. No, it's not going to be a coronavirus. Stop it. You're stupid. It's ridiculous. It's just another fucking flu. Shut your fucking mouth. Stop fucking grounding fucking planes. Stop fucking quarantine. It's fucking the flu. You know what the flu kills? Here's what it kills. It kills people from 0 to 5 years old and from 58 to 75. That's who it kills. Every Stop fucking year. Freaking out. It happens every year. You know how many people die of heart disease, cancer, fucking AIDS? Stop it. Just
way,
stop it. You're lunatics. Oh, the coronavirus. It's going to kill everybody. I'm going to pull my kid from school. You're a fucking idiot. You're an idiot.
By the way, that hook, you know that stripper that fell off the pole and broke her
jaw?
Oh,
my God.
She's already got $30,000 in GoFundMe. Seriously.
No, she was a fucking beast. She hit that shit and just kept twerking like it was
her
fucking...
She kept twerking.
Oh, my God. I was like, oh, my God. If I was single and lived there, I'd be like, I want to marry you. You're a tough bitch. You're a tough bitch. You do that and just keep going. Holy fuck. You know what's funny? It's a guy who sent it to me. It was another tree guy I know. And he sent me to that. He said, what do you think? I'm like, that's a bad bitch. Like, that's a bad bitch. Like, I don't know how you fall. What, like 15 feet at least?
Oh, she fell hard. Did she? And you said, George, that she broke her jaw?
Yeah, I mean, they said it was that, you know, that she broke her jaw, and I'm like,
And she, like, from what I could see, like, she still was, like, twerking her ass, like, whoa.
She's probably on a contract, and she didn't finish that shit, she didn't get her money, so she just cowboyed the fuck up and did it. Well, good for her.
Or in shock of, like, what actually fucking happened. But
adrenaline.
Yeah,
is.
Adrenaline and shock and stuff, like, that had to play into it. However, somebody that just falls and hits that hard, you know, they ain't gonna fucking twerk.
She's committed. All right, final thoughts.
Committed.
Final thoughts. Jade Lopez, what you got?
I want to know and ask the chat and stuff like that. Do you guys enjoy us playing games or covering more news stories or random stories? I want to know.
Put that in the chat, put that on the bar, put it on a VRS in care of the bar, and yeah, I would love
to do
that.
Take care of yourself, and if you need help, reach out.
Please, absolutely. Chris, what you got for us?
Springtime's coming, it's getting better, and I want to say...
Kayak season! Yeah,
damn right, I get excited about that. I also want to say, if you steal and somebody else doesn't steal, that person's better than you. You lie and somebody else doesn't lie, that other person is better than you. Try to make yourself better every day.
Alright, so I want to address this. Roxanne says, final thoughts. Be a stripper. It pays better than workers' compensation. Well, maybe. And
I want to say this.
I want to say, hold on. Let me say this. Roxanne, you're an amazingly beautiful woman. She's smoking hot. She's easily a 9. Easily enough.
Oh, she's gorgeous.
Oh, yeah,
Absolutely. She is.
It's ridiculous.
I love you.
So don't worry. No worries. Keep working hard. You be good. And don't ever go to a strip club. I will seriously I'll find you and bring a baseball bat for the owner specifically. George, what'd you
I'll just bring ones. I'll bring fives.
With everything that's going on in the world right now, if you're going to do something stupid, At least let us have the video rights to it at the bar,
right?
Or VRS. We will monetize the shit out of it.
Yes!
Church is hilarious.
Oh, my God. I'm going to hell. And,
you're not going to hell.
I'm driving
There's
the
no
bus.
Way. There's no way.
No. And also, if you're posting pictures of the broom and your house looks like a haunted house, you know, in Halloween, maybe clean up the house a little bit better first.
Yeah, all right.
I gotta go. Good night. Love you guys.
Night, George. My final thoughts. Love you all. Love your show. Thank you to George Farber. Thank you to Chris Cornell. Thank you to Jade Lopez. Thank you to everybody who turned in the show, including my dad, including my brother-in-law, my dad, Bill Kramer, aka Pops, who you can find every Sunday at 1900 Eastern Standard Time on Sports Church. Roxanne, thank you all. No, I wouldn't. Absolutely. Well, Dance and Bowl, I believe, is an amazing workout. Well, it absolutely is. But, no, not going to go there. You're too gorgeous.
I ain't
going to
do it for a job, sweetie.
No,
though.
You're too gorgeous. And, yeah, it's just, yeah, you're absolutely gorgeous. And I still am unbelievably befuddled why you don't have a great man with your life, because you're smoking hot and you're sweet and you're good and you support us. So one day, I don't know, maybe we should stop looking. Maybe you should stop looking and you'll just find that fucking dream guy. Other than that, thank you all for tuning into the VRS bar right here in the Veteran Radio Syndicate, the recognized symbol of excellence and online entertainment for veterans and patriots. I am Mini-Me. Joining me, Miss J. Lopez, the compound commander, formerly Mr. how do I call him? How do I say this nicely? The Bear. Join us, which you can catch every Thursday for the Bear at the Warrior Wall, and every Sunday for the Bear News. I love you all. Please continue to share our show wherever and whenever you can. We love you all. On our mission in life is to entertain your veterans, so please don't take a
permanent solution to a temporary problem.
Thank you. All right. Love you all. And we are out. Eventually.
And happy Valentine's Day.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. By the way, yeah, we didn't cover that.
Mother bitches.
I can't.
Push the button. Love y'all.
I'm going to do it another way.
Thank you.